Hi, welcome to Total Sound. My name is Ron Curtis.
I'm Dory Diamond.
Who's our guest tonight, Dory?
Tonight we have Bill Bruford with Bill Bruford's Earthworks.
That's right. Total Sound is an alternative music program which showcases music and musicians that don't always get the spotlight. We have a great interview with Bill, plus some live music and some other interesting surprises. So here it is for you.
Total Sound.
That's right. Our guest tonight, or whenever this is shown, is Mr. Bill Bruford, drummer, composer, and all-around good fellow.
Bon vivant.
Bon vivant from Earthworks, currently touring the United States with Bill Bruford's
Hello,
Earthworks.
And welcome to room 302.
That's right. We're in
Welcome to the big time. Isn't it lovely?
We're in the Palos Verdes Inn here. And Bill, we have many questions.
I can see they're all written down. I'm ready.
You have many answers. And yep. We were with you today at KCRW,
mm-hmm.
and you were doing an interview, and you were mentioning that KCRW is one of the stations that gives your music a chance and
mm-hmm.
plays it.
Mm-hmm.
With all the tight radio playlists and everything that's going on, what is it that you feel can be done in order to enlarge your audience, in order to give the radio stations a kick in the butt to play some more of your music?
Oh, well, I mean, I'm really not on a crusade here. It's the way the American scene is set up right now. Something might change. Usually an oil crisis or two has a big effect. The last time there was a big change was really in 73 when the Arabs, whacked up the price of oil and vinyl.
For the vinyl, sure.
Vinyl went cost. Through the roof. Records suddenly doubled in price, whatever it was.
Now we have CDs, though.
Yeah, you do, so I don't quite know what happens next. But there's no doubt it's a difficult time for, music with funny bits in it.
Music with funny bits, is that how you know?
Music that does anything that deviates at all from the norm being, let's say, for the point of argument, the Fleetwood Mac LP.
So intelligent music as opposed to bland.
No, I didn't say that. You said that.
Well, that's what I think.
That this is called the intelligence of jazz.
I believe that.
Well, there we go.
No. There is a sort of norm of pop music, and that is, in the interest of companies to keep that going around. And that sort of spoils the market for the rest of us. In other words, every time Genesis makes 2 or 3 million or spends 2 or 3 million making an LP, that's a lot of money that other guys could also use to make LPs with stranger music. We'll be right back. part of the sound of Earthworks is it is an attractive sound. It is designed to be attractive as opposed to repellent.
Right.
I mean, there are groups that will repel you deliberately so. You know, Archie Shepp in his heyday, or King Crimson when it was really going. You know, they can be repellent orally, just up here in the ears. Earthworks is not like that at all. It's inviting you into it. Most of the lead sounds are warm, brass, or wooden.
Right.
Most of the drum sounds are fairly delicate, although we can get noisy. But it's an inviting kind of thing, an airy, inviting sound, which is deliberately constructed.
You made a really interesting comment. We were in the car earlier. You were saying that with all the bands and all the projects and things you've done, you tend to outgrow groups. You just tend to outgrow a situation. I mean, you look at the Rolling Stones, or look at the Kinks, or, you know, the Who keeps coming back. You know, they break up, they come back, and this and this. But you were very honest in saying that, you know, you get to the point where you outgrow a situation, you don't feel the need to go back to it, as you mentioned with Patrick Moraz.
Yeah, that's generally the case. Yeah, you put something together as a vehicle for your ideas at that time.
And if it doesn't apply anymore, it's
well, yeah, pretty much. That's it. And you work through that series of ideas. Let's say with my own band, I was very keen on writing, very keen on the this is the Bruford band with Alan Holdsworth and Jeff Berlin. Very keen on the clanging sound of brilliant rototoms.
Right.
Very keen on using Alan, who introducing him to America as well. Very keen on odd meters. It's very much an odd meter group that was as a way of playing the drums. And you work through that, and then you know you go on to another thing, and after a while you think, well, maybe this whole combination of horns and keyboards and upright bass would be an interesting way to go. And you do that, and people grow naturally through these things, as musicians do.
Are we going to do the bass?
Hi, we're here with Django Bates from Earthworks. Hello, it's nice to see you. We're going to be doing what we just did with Bill. We're going to have some information about some of his keyboards. He's keyboard player and horn player for Earthworks. This is the most interesting looking horn. It looks like an antique.
Yeah, I should start with this. It's the simplest out of all this stuff.
What do we call this?
Well, in England it seems to be called tenor horn, and out here I've heard it called alto horn. And some guy described it as a peck horn, and he told me it's because in the brass bands it just goes peck, 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 and just plays the offbeats all the time, so that's a good name for it.
So this is an actual piece of equipment that is never hooked up to any electronics, and we kind of use it as...
Not yet. I suppose I could get around to that, but it would just mean it would get complicated like everything else.
Is it actually an antique? I mean, is this considerably old?
It just looks very old. The lacquer's come off it for some reason, and I think I should leave it like this. It sounds quite good without it.
It looks wonderful. Yeah. Of course, you don't want to alter it by...
I don't want to take any risks. Yeah,
I don't blame you. Yeah. Perhaps you could blow a few notes on it. And
it's in E-flat, and it's sort of somewhere in between flugel and euphonium, whatever.
It's got a good range on it as well. It goes from...
Later on tonight, it'll go a lot higher when I'm warmed up.
Almost like a mixture between a tuba and a flugelhorn, sort of?
Yeah, somewhere in there.
It's pretty
sort
amazing.
Sort of brass bands of England use.
This is primarily the horn that you would play in Earthworks, or...?
Definitely, yeah. I started on trumpet, but I just found it very hard to get any individual sound out of a trumpet.
And certainly, I've never seen any musicians playing this before, so you're probably all by yourself.
Good.
As
no
good.
No competition.
No, absolutely. Yeah. And as far as the keyboards go, we have your basic synthesizer setup and sampler over here. Do you ever take any, for example, any of the sounds from any other horns and things and incorporate them into the keyboard banks that we have?
I've got one sampler, and that's... that's the Ensoniq, and I have sampled, not horns so much, I've sampled me hitting a bell and singing a note, which came out quite nicely. That was quite useful.
That's wonderful. Kids in England that are getting involved in jazz now, a lot of this equipment, a lot of the equipment that Earthworks uses is expensive. It's not the type of equipment that is as easy to get as a trumpet or a saxophone or an acoustic bass or whatever. And Earthworks really seems to be alone in being able to incorporate electronics into what is essentially jazz. Do you feel that if the kids did have more access, money-wise or whatever, to this type of equipment, that the state of British jazz would lean a little more towards electronics? Or do you think that they would stay away from it and want to stay more traditional?
I think it's not so much to do with gear as just to do with what they listen to and what they want to reproduce or what they want to get away from, depending on the way they feel about music, whether they want to recreate something or get something new. I mean, I got into this by accident. Someone kept on nagging me to get the synthesizer because I was just playing Fender Rhodes
right
on this gig. And I accidentally got this, which is like, everyone who saw it said, "That's a mistake, man, those are going out of fashion." And of course, 3 years later, everyone wants one. This is the Prophet 5.
Right.
And this, I don't know, you can get these for about £400, $800 now. And it's not really a hell of a lot of money.
Would you say that the kids, the jazz purists, would really want to stay away from electronics because it would remind them too much of the fusion bands that they feel might be a little excessive in their soloing?
I think a lot of them maybe wouldn't even know what to do with it instinctively because none of the sounds would suggest anything to them, whereas they can sit down at a piano and that's going to suggest Toby Hancock or whatever. Yeah.
So we wanted to talk a little about your other current project, Anderson, Bruford, Wakeman, and Howe. I understand there's a second album.
We finished a second album. Yeah, that's a sort of an epic in itself. That's been running for a while. That started in around March or April.
How is it that you guys came together? I mean, there's press about the fighting, about the
band. John came around and said, what's this about an SDX, which is the instrument I play? And I said, come on, show you what it does, and he really liked that. I mean, he thought it was great. Typical John Anderson, absolutely loved the SDX, could do a million things at once, could sound like Aboriginal Heat.
Right.
Could sound like Ayers Rock at 110 degrees,
There you go.
And so he said, that's nice, and I thought, at the end of that conversation, I was going to play on one of his solo records. But things change, and by the time Steve Howe turned up and Rick Wakeman and we made this LP, then people are saying, the best way to promote this is to go on tour. Do you want to come on tour? And usually you'll find musicians say yes rather than no. It's in their system.
It's just in your blood, right?
If people ask you, you say yes. It's what actors and musicians do, generally speaking. It's tough to say no.
There wasn't any animosity or anything within the band after, or let's say a sense of not being together after all this time.
I don't know.
Can we do it again?
I'm not going to go out and collect Rick Wakeman. it's not my style. But I mean,
he has 24 solo albums.
I take a guy as I find him. If he's there at a session and he can play the music and he can stand up straight and he sounds good, which Rick does, and can do all those three things, then that's fine. I'm trying to downgrade this stuff. You see, you guys think about this stuff a lot. We don't think about
it. You want to play your music and make
music. Yeah, I'm saying, who's playing keyboards?
That blows me away.
On the way to the studio, I say, I wonder who's playing keyboards on this, to myself. I say, maybe it's Rick. Walk in, there's Rick. Hello, Rick. How are you? Boom, 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 boom.
Hi. We're here at the Strand with Bill Bruford, who is graciously going to be telling us a little bit about his wonderful Simmons electronic drum kit, etc. Bill?
Oh, not so wonderful.
It's
depending
not?
On whether you play it or not.
Well, I wouldn't know the first thing about this.
Well,
you could give us a little
kind
idea.
It's kind of the heart of the band, really, and a number of pads, and the idea of being, of course, a drummer's fantasy, that generally any pad can be any sound. So there are basic drums. But all that stuff can change fairly easily if I select another patch over here. All this equipment shifts and then it turns into pitches, which can then be sustained.
You're a virtual orchestra here.
I'm an orchestra.
You're a virtual orchestra.
Chords plus drums.
Stromboli kicks.
Correct. And these patches can be shifted via a a little foot pedal here, which allows me to shift through them. So we have, but then we could have, or we could have, or we could have. So the drum set can be anything that you want it to be at any time, depending on what the composition calls for.
This is really amazing. When you says a zone intelligent, is that sort of praising itself as being such an intelligent piece of work?
This reads information across the pad, uh-huh, as well as under velocity. The harder you hit it, different things happen. If you're back over here doing something like this, as I move across, of course, it's different pitches from the conga drum, depending on where you play. Depending on where you move around on the pad and how hard you hit it,
right,
any information you've stored comes up on this TV screen. I've got TV here.
Unbelievable.
So I can watch the game. Things get a little tedious.
The World
music.
Series is on, that's right.
World Series.
That's right. You know, it is amazing to me now, the drummer as composer.
Well, drummers have always written, actually. They've always composed. But it's just that an instrument like this can give you a variety of nice ideas. Such as the kind of thing I've been demonstrating. You know, you can, of course, store it all. It's instantly recallable. And the idea is that basically the audience should never care about any of this stuff at all. This is part of my equipment, and it should be easy for me to operate and not in any way intrude in what you're delivering to the crowd.
Now, of course, you have all the electronic equipment here, but does the snare drum and the cymbals basically remain the core of the drum kit? As far as keeping their original sound, do you actually do anything with the cymbals and the snare drum?
Yeah, of course. Apart from play them, they are cymbals and snare drum. That's,
right,
that's
but
all
there isn't anything that you would use in order to modify their sound the same way as you would with the sound?
No, sometimes the pads turn into cymbals too. But generally, these are the kind of sounds that I particularly want.
Right.
So I'm happy to keep these live, real metals and the real snare as part of the heart of the matter, and there is, of course, all this electronic stuff as well.
One more question before we go. When you are composing an idea, do you compose them actually on the drums? Do you have do you play keyboards, per se, to be able to put together the melody lines that you use?
Yeah, I'm kind of a frustrated keyboard player as well. So this is, as it were, a half and half. It's a hybrid drum set and keyboard set, so I can play certain keyboard figures from here. I mean, I could play this part on the keyboard, but it wouldn't sound the same. The notes are actually just coming from the keyboard. You could have a keyboard player play this, but it's not going to sound the same. It's the rolling feel of the drums that you're after. So
right.
I'm trying hard not to duplicate something that Django Bates might want to do over there. I don't want to tread on his toes. We're looking for complementary parts.
Thank you.
fortunate enough to perform at a fairly high standard with some of these guys, and I don't think I'm going to go and join a bar band in a hurry. You know, it's too important to me. You know, I'd rather not play at all than play some jam. Really.
Any chance of another solo album, or do you think that all your energies in Earthworks are kind of satisfying
well,
that?
I hope I have something called Bill Bruford's Earthworks for a long time. Whether it is this particular configuration of musicians, I wouldn't know, but let's hope that we have a Bill Bruford's Earthworks that would be a vehicle for my suitably rabid and manic ideas for a
so while. I certainly do hope so.
So perhaps
it's
a situation,
lovely, wonderful music.
Situation like King Crimson, maybe. You have one person that's basically involved with the direction of the band.
Yeah, I think we have Bill Bruford's Earthworks, that I would use or not use as I saw fit.
And we look forward to having you with us next time you're here, and we're very glad that you could be here with us tonight, and we look forward to the show that we're going to be seeing and everything else. And
that's very kind. Thanks.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks for your questions.
Thank for
you.
Ron and Dory, this is Total Sound, and we'd like to thank you for being with us, and tune in next time for more. Good night. Thank you.